I have a question to you. Are we truly aware of how blessed we are? Are we truly aware of all the blessings that are poured out on us? And really, I ask that knowing that the answer is no. I know that none of us are truly aware of how blessed we are, or we'd have a radically different attitude to all the multitude of blessings that God rains down, pours down upon us. Fresh air. Sometimes people hear some people say, I'm just glad that I'm alive. I wake up in the morning and say, thank you, Lord, for another new day. And we do need more of that attitude, don't we? Ongoing through our lives for every gift he gives us, every precious gift, fresh air, clean running water that we have in this land, for homes to live in, for food, for family. And for those of us in churches, the Bible, the revelation of God's truth made known to us. What a huge blessing that is. Let's look at this chapter in Deuteronomy. Chapter 2 of Deuteronomy. I just want you to remember that we're looking at this, it's in God's Word. God's Word is there for our benefit. Whether we're yet to trust in the Lord Jesus, he guides us to. If we are already trusting in him, and walking with him on the narrow way, it shows us that's the root of all our belief and what we should be believing, how we should be walking, and lessons to learn from those who either walked with him or walked away from the Lord. And we see in this chapter that the Israelites were punished for their unbelief in God. And so they had to be wanderers in the desert for the best part of 40 years. And yet there was still so much that the Lord had given them. Yes, there were many, many blessings. And Moses points out a few of these. This is verse 7 on page 180 in the Church Bibles. And it says this, Moses said to them, the Lord your God has blessed you in all the work of your hands. Think of it, when the tabernacle, he asked them to make all lots of different fine cloths and different things, gold and all sorts of things that were asked for, commanded. And there were particular people who were gifted, yes, but everyone was involved in that. And the Lord blessed them in the work of their hands. And you might think, well, that's just, what's the tabernacle? That's no big deal. Well, it was. Because that was the prescribed way in which they were to honour and worship the Lord. And that's a big thing. That is a big thing. We're just used to a casual modern age, aren't we? Perhaps some of us, and people older than me, not no disrespect, the opposite, honour, greater honour, you lived in a different time where you had school teachers and were called school masters, maybe even robed school teachers, and you had to obey them. And there was much respect given to them. Think about it. Think of what the Lord has said and how we are to respond to what he said. It's not just, oh, well, I can do it in my own time. I'll do it if I have time. But the Lord has said this. So the Israelites, they do everything. Now, yes, those things of the tabernacle might well be important in terms of symbolism. If they've got blue and green and red cloth or whatever it might be. And following those things to the letter, you might look at it and say, well, yes, it looks good, and it might show that, you know, God has a great fullness and he's in charge of everything, and he ordained colour into existence. You know, he loves the richness of life. that he's given us. And you look at the animal kingdom, you know, we look at some bizarre frog or something like that from the rainforest and think, how did it end up those colours? Well, the Lord ordained it so. He obviously enjoys colour. And it's a reflection of his own creativity, his own power, and his own love for what he's made. But ultimately, it's not simply, oh, those things are colourful, those things are to be followed, but much more that, it's actually that we honour him in doing so. We don't have to always ask, why is this so? We don't always have to ask, oh, God wants this, and do I have to know why? Every intimate detail. Well, yes, maybe it is good ultimately to know. Some things we'll never know. But we have to simply trust him and obey him. Okay. So, sorry, it was a bit long way to get to that point. So, the Lord has blessed them in all the work of their hands. That's the first thing Moses said about the Israelites. He's blessed you in all the work of your hands. And then he says, he's watched over your journey through this vast desert. And I don't know if you've looked up all the dangers of the desert. There are many. And that's just, you know, somebody passing through the desert. Imagine living in the desert for 40 whole years. All the dangers of the desert. And yet they've been protected from those dangers. Watched over their journey through that vast desert. And then, of course, the Lord himself had been with them all that time. He was watching over you. These 40 years, the Lord your God has been with you. And again, we're people of sight, aren't we? You know, if we see it, we can get excited by it for whatever reason. If we don't see it, yeah, out of sight, out of mind. And we mustn't be like that with the Lord. We must trust in what he has written, and how he has revealed himself, and said, well, this is the God of care and of love and attention and of power, of might. And this Lord has revealed himself to us in these unique ways. Ways in which we, things that we cannot do. Can you make a sky? Can you make a cloud? Can you make a sunset? Can you make a tree? Plant? Can you make a human? Can you make this earth? Can you make the stars? No, of course not. He can do these things. And of course, because he created all these different laws of science, these laws that govern nature, he can always tear them up from time to time as he chooses. No. Not to create chaos, but simply to show his power. But the Lord himself had been with them all that time. The Lord of glory, the Lord of power, he has chosen this nation as being unique just because he chose them. That can be an issue for us in our minds. Why? Why does he choose some and not others? We don't know why. We simply, again, have to trust him and enjoy the fact that we have heard his word. We have heard his call, and we step out in faith, trust and love in him. And it says there, the last thing in that verse 7, Deuteronomy 2, verse 7, these 40 years the Lord your God has been with you, so important, and you have not lacked anything. You have not lacked anything. Now, in the Bible, we have what we call common grace. So perhaps we could say, stereotypically, or your ungrateful next door neighbour, or it might not be your next door neighbour, but somebody else who lives somewhere around us will say, I don't really care about God. I don't care about being grateful for the things that you are. But there's common grace. This is in Matthew 5, verse 45. So in the first chapter of the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus there says, I tell you, he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. God is loving and giving to the undeserving. He causes sun to shine on those people who are righteous and those who are unrighteous. He sends all these good things as common grace to us. So there's that category of, there are lots of blessings that come from the Lord, whether we appreciate them or not. But then there's special grace. And there's special grace in this Jewish nation that we're looking at here in Deuteronomy and all the way through the Bible, really. Special grace that they've been given. As we said, he takes this one man. What's his name? What's the one man he started the Jews with? Abraham. Yeah, he takes one man from a completely different background to what he ends up in. He starts with a sophisticated man in the city of Ur, and he takes him out. He says, you're going to live in tents the rest of your life, but you're going to be following and worshipping me, and you, I'm going to grow you into a great nation. And the Lord makes good on his promise, as he makes good on every promise. That's the special grace of God in the Jewish nation he forms. And here we are in Deuteronomy. He has already formed a people, but they're not in the land yet. Didn't you notice there how they have to follow what he has said? They don't just say, well, any land you want. It's not just a case of, well, it doesn't seem to be anybody here, or maybe I'm supposed to take it off these people. No, do you notice that in verse 5? Do not provoke them to war with the sons of Esau, for I will not give you any of their land, not even enough to put your foot on. It's very graphic, isn't it? You know, think, well, that's not very much land. No, not even that much, because that's not for you. I haven't ordained that for you. And we get a touch of that as well in Acts 17, 26, where Paul is speaking to the people in Athens, and he's saying that the Lord has selected, chosen the exact places where you should live. And yeah, we see that here in the Israelites' journey. So common grace given to all, but special grace given to the Jewish nation, and special grace given to those who trust him today. Are you one of them? Are you one of those who trusts Jesus? Who says, yes, I see God at work in the world, but most of all, I see him at work in the sending of Jesus to be my saviour. I trust in him. Special grace indeed. Now, in verse 4, these people who are mentioned there as the descendants of Esau are called your brothers. And it mentions it two or three times, your brothers, again in verse 8. And yes, they were brothers by blood, but not spiritual brothers. Hebrews 12 describes Esau as godless. Do not be godless like Esau, who sold his inheritance for a bowl of stew. Godless. Just looking at the short term. Not seeing things as God sees them. You know, we've all got people in our lives who we're related to by blood. But it is our spiritual family that we're on our way to heaven with. And I'm not saying I'm rejecting our blood family. No, I'm not saying that at all. But it is, we do have two different families, do we not? And that's made apparent here as well. Yes, they're brothers on one level, but not on another, because they're not part of the inheritance of Israel. Now, there's a very somber truth in verse 15. I want you to look at that now. Deuteronomy 2:15. And it says there that the Lord's hand was completely against them. That's the generation, the entire generation of fighting men that had perished from the camp, as the Lord had sworn to them. Their Lord's hand was against them until he had completely eliminated them from the camp. The Lord's hand was against them. And I think, what a terrifying prospect that is, for the Almighty Creator to be against you. You know, we've already talked about the power of God in creation. You know, what does it take to make what we see around us, you know, whether near or far, you know, whether it's an insect or a hill or a star? And it's incomprehensible. We don't really know what real power is, because we only have what's given to us, what's handed down to us in a small amount. You know, even the strongest man in the world, or woman in the world, only has a very, 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 very limited amount of strength in comparison to the creative strength that God has. But imagine all that power. We often look at it in a good way, yes, and that's not a bad thing. We say, wow, what awesome, great power he has. But then turn it the other way and say, imagine that power, the one who has that much power, to be against you. That is really a terrifying prospect. And think of it here, for the Israelite people, he's shown them love and favour and all these many blessings, but they've rejected him. You know, we say of some people, ooh, you don't want to get on the wrong side of her. I remember being in the back garden at my last house in London, and overhearing the son who was visiting with his little children, and saying of our neighbour, now you know what Nanny's like, you don't want to get on the wrong side of her, you know, you don't want to get don't want to wind her up, you want to do what is right, what she's asked you to do. And yet, of course, such people, they're simply fellow humans. There's only a certain amount that they really can do. And there's no comparison with any human to the God who's made us all. This God, the Almighty Creator, the true power that the Lord God Almighty possesses. Now, you must admit that there's been a turning away from preaching about hell over the last 60 years, probably. When people will say, oh, I don't really like that church because it's all fire and brimstone. What are they trying to say? They're trying to say, well, we'd rather hear about Jesus' love. We'd rather hear about, you know, something nice. But what did Jesus say? Was Jesus just talking about love? Have you read the Gospels? He spoke about hell more than anybody else. He didn't hold fire. To be with Jesus was not simply be just wafted around and spread sort of love and warmth with everybody. People heard him and heard him speak about the danger of hell, of rejecting him, of rejecting his message. And so we must also, as much as we speak about the God of love and of forgiveness, we must also speak of the God of power, of destruction, here eliminating us. Suffering of hell is something that Jesus spoke about often, and we need to remember that. But the great thing is, don't miss this, the Lord's hand does not have to be against us. Yeah? The Lord's hand doesn't have to be against us. It's not for us to say, ooh, we're doomed. No, because the gospel is open to us. The gospel is there. We can know the good news. God, has created us, yes, and God rules, but he has provided. Provided a saviour. We are sinners. We know that we've done wrong. We're going to die. That's the death penalty, because sinners deserve that death penalty. But the Lord Jesus has provided a saviour, and we can know him. The Lord's hand does not have to be against us, and he offers salvation. And his salvation, we must understand what it is at its crux, at the kernel, as it were, the very heart of it. It's not simply being let off. It's like, I'll carry on as I am, but without the spectre of doom over me. No, it's not about being let off. It's having the sin barrier removed so that we can now move forward and come towards and let the Lord embrace us. Do you see the difference? It's not just, I can still carry on walking on this side and God's somewhere over there, and I'll just walk away. I don't have that mark against my name anymore. The sin is removed, the barrier is removed, so that we can run to him, so that he can pick us up in his arms, so that he can hold us close, and we can walk with him. That's the purpose. It's so that we can have the fellowship with him that we're all made to have. Infinitely greater than simply being let off, the Lord has sent his Son to deal with our sins so that we can have the closest possible fellowship with him. And in all this, I hope that you're seeing that all people in every age, in any setting, are really just in one of two categories. Those who have that saving faith in God, take him at his word, put their faith in him, and those who do not. And those Israelites in the wilderness, nearly all of them lost their lives because they refused to trust in God. And you could say, well, yes, they're given so much, and yet they refused God, given so much, and yet rejecting the giver. And so God refused to allow them to enter. Not just entering into the land, but ultimately entering into his rest. We've looked at that before, haven't we? Hebrews chapter 3, if you want to look at that another time. Hebrews chapter 3 and 4. Think of the many hundreds, if not thousands, of people who've come to this building since 1880. 140 long years. 144 years. And like the Israelites, blessed not only with common grace, the good things that God gives to everyone, but also with that special grace of being able to have the opportunity to know true life through Jesus. And hearing the news of how they can be right with God. Some have trusted in God and some have not. Given the privilege of hearing the gospel that saves, and yet so many refuse. And so God will refuse to receive them into his new creation. And to enter into his new creation, we have to become new creations. That's what it says in 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, the old is gone, the new has come. If anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. New from the inside out. There are consequences to all our decisions, but none bigger than refusing to trust in God and his gospel. Perhaps it's our arrogance if we believe we know better than God. There are some people who would put God in the dock, isn't it? That they will judge God and they will say, I'm more moral than he is. What about these people who are dying in this country? What about this? And we would say, well, I don't know. I don't know all the ways and the purposes of God. But that doesn't mean to say that you try him. It doesn't mean to say that you stand in judgment of him as if you're more moral
than he is. That really is arrogance, isn't it? And to turn to Hebrews 12. And, particularly the last couple of verses of that chapter. This last half of the chapter of Hebrews 12, it speaks of what the Israelites experienced, saying you haven't come to a mountain that can be touched and that is burning with fire, to darkness, gloom and storm. No, you haven't experienced that. As Christians, we've come to Mount Zion that we were singing about earlier, awake, awake, O Zion. You've come to the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God. You've come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly, to the church of the firstborn, to those names whose names are written in heaven. This is the church of the firstborn got all the privileges. And guess what? When we're in God's family, every single one of us is a firstborn. Yeah. We all get the best, God's best. Amazing, isn't it? And at the end of that, talking about how wonderful and privileged we are as people of this new day after Jesus has come and died and risen again and ascended and been glorified. We have these privileges, however, verse 28 of Hebrews 12, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Don't think, as some people immaturely do, that there's a kind of God of the Old Testament and God of the New. Don't think, oh yes, one time he acted in anger. In an ultimate power, and now he's just light and love. It's the same God all the way through. You can see here, as we travelled with the Israelites, he's offered that light and that love. You know, travelling around there with a pillar of fire by night and cloud by day. He's leading them, loving them, accompanying them with his grace. Sharing his heart with them. Here are commands which please me, which will also help you in every sphere of your lives. It is kindness. There are warnings. They're kindness too. Don't do this because you'll get into trouble. We don't tell our children not to do something because we want to make their lives difficult. Because we love them. We're showing that we care for them. The same is true with God and us. And so, we must accept, we must worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. He is still the same God now, as he always was. And we must worship him acceptably. As I said before, perhaps we can be casual in different ways. And we might be more casual in our dress than people of a different age. And not complaining about what you're wearing today. No, but our attitude must always be right before God. We must always be the people that he wants us to be. We must meet him one-to-one. We must meet him every day. We must walk with him every day. We've got to pray through each day. We've got to be people who rely upon him every moment, in the ordinary things of life, and but particularly in those testing times, where things, where trials, perhaps the moments of temptation, maybe the times of great loss in our lives, losing loved ones, might be a whole host of different things. And we've got to be close to him. It's the same whether we live in the age of Paul the Apostle, 500 years ago, or here today. We must worship God acceptably, reverence and all, and know his position and our position, but enjoy that. It is light and love, and it's reverence and awe. He is a consuming fire. And enjoy these things together. It's not for us to be thoughtless or careless in our worship of the Almighty God. And so we must remember who God is and what he has provided, and enjoy that. And as much as we can come here and listen to a sermon, and it can be hopefully some form of meat, of good solid stuff for us to enjoy together, don't let this be it. Meet with him each day. Set aside time, make time to share with him, just you and him. So important. The boys have got some questions. I might run through these four questions with you now to close. In what ways had the Lord blessed the Israelites? What ways had he blessed them? Well, remember, don't we? The Lord was with them. The Lord was with them all through that journey. They hadn't lacked anything. They'd been blessed in the work of their hands. The second question is, why is God's power and authority different to ours? It's completely different, isn't it? Someone's anger, even if it was so bad that they could kill us, as the Lord said in Luke 12, they've got the power to kill your body, yes, but fear him who has the power to throw you into hell. So God's power and authority is completely different to ours on another level. Question three, why is God's salvation not simply being let off? It's so much deeper than that, so much greater than that, isn't it? God's salvation isn't being let off. It's removing the sin barrier between us with my sin so that I can meet with God, know him, know his newness of life, have the Holy Spirit living in me. And the last question, question four, are you trusting in Jesus' work for you, all that he came to do? Are you trusting in that? And if yes, when did that start? When did that start? It's a challenge for us. We need to keep going on in that, don't we? Keep growing on, going on, growing up in our Christian lives. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your gentle hand, how you led the Israelites, even though they had rejected you, and you caused them to wander in that desert those many long years, and yet you still provided for them. And you preserved their lives, that their descendants might be the ones who would go and inherit the land and possess it. Father, we pray that we would be people who before you regularly, reading your word, spending time with you in prayer, enjoying you. Once we know your life within us, and if there be anybody here who's still yet to trust in you for the first time, please reveal the fullness of yourself and your gospel mission, all you came to do. Yes, you came for the world, for God so loved the world, and yet the world is made of millions and millions of individuals. Each of us, we can have our own relationship with you. Glory to you, Lord. Thank you for your plans and purposes. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.